Good evening, folks. Tonight on the Rock Newman Show, some look at our black boys and see trouble. But Umar Johnson, a descendant of famed abolitionist Frederick Douglass, sees hope. Today he talks about his mission to make sure every African-American boy receives the education he deserves. That's coming up right now on the Rock Newman Show. Welcome to the Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University located in the nation's capital. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. Psychoacademic Holocaust, the special education and ADHD wars against black boys. If you can't tell by the title of Umar Johnson's new book, he is serious about making sure African-American students and their families don't fall prey to the institutional racism that is so rampant in this country's schools. He is here today to tell you about how to protect your sons. Welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for being here today. I think it would be correctly said that there is a crisis in the black community on multiple levels. As you've crisscrossed this country, you've inspired, you've electrified audience, you've upset folks. You've challenged them, you've provoked communities of color and spoken very harshly sometimes about the forces that you see as contributing to the demise, direct demise of the African-American community, especially African-American boys.
Yes.
Why have you chosen African-American boys as your pursuit of justice, if we can call it that?
As a school psychologist, my responsibility is to evaluate and determine which children have disabilities and a subsequent need for special education. Working in a predominantly African-American community, Philadelphia, the school district of Philadelphia, where I began my career, I was often asked to evaluate African-American and Latino boys to see if they had learning disabilities that would give them the opportunity to receive special ed support. And 9 out of every 10 boys that I evaluated for special education service exhibited no evidence of a learning disability. And so every day I'm going to work, and this began in my internship year, which was the year 2000. I'm going to work and I'm testing child after child, IQ tests, reading tests, math tests, and I'm saying that you're correct. These children have skill deficits, but they're not learning disabled. They simply haven't been taught. And so more experience over these past 15 years and more research led me to the reasons why this was happening, predominantly because special education is a financial machine. When children go to special ed, the schools get extra money. So the primary reason for why so many black and Latino boys were being sentenced to special education is because it equaled an economic stimulus package for the school. Secondly, a lot of it had to do with racism and discrimination. I found that a lot of our teachers, not all, but many, particularly our European American teachers, they didn't have the same type of confidence in a child's ability to learn, and so they were more quickly willing to refer them for a special education evaluation. And then I also saw how African-American parents being undereducated and miseducated about what special education and ADHD was were actually going along in this process, being complicit in the oppression of black boys because they bought into this message that said special ed and ADHD was a benefit, not a detriment.
That is a terrifying statistic, that 9 out of 10 black boys that you studied, that you worked with, who were being designated for special education really didn't belong in a special education class.
Yes.
You know what? You just mentioned something, ADHD. We hear it all the time, hear it talked about sometimes in a much what I think to be too cavalier manner. Can you describe for us ADHD? What are we talking about here and what's the impact?
Sure. The mother diagnosis of ADHD was ADD, attention deficit disorder, which I believe the American Psychiatric Association gave us in 1990. And then in the year 2000, it metamorphosed into ADHD. So it went from ADD for about 10 years and then ADHD, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. In the original version, it was only attention deficit. They added the hyperactivity later. That became necessary to justify the wholesale drugging of black boys. See, there is no drug that can make you pay attention. So when you diagnose a child as ADHD, you really don't open up an opportunity for the prescription to be given. But once you add hyperactivity, now you're talking about a behavioral manifestation that can be addressed with medication. So the ADHD became necessary in order for the drug companies to profit off of the diagnosis. And ADHD has spiraled out of control now because everyone thinks that they are expert in giving the diagnosis. Teachers, parents, principals, everyone thinks that just because a child has difficulty sitting still or paying attention, they automatically have ADHD. Some of that has to do with the fact that the criteria for ADHD is so generally laid out that anyone could qualify for it. You, me, and every child in America, black, white, purple, rich or poor. Symptoms such as losing things necessary to complete their work, not being able to pay attention to detail, having difficulty playing quietly, blurting out answers, moving as if they're driven by a motor, tapping with their fingers or feet. What child do you know doesn't do this? I do it as an adult. Yeah. And from a conspiracy perspective, that's done on purpose. Because the more general the criteria, the easier it is to diagnose, the more children get prescribed medicine. And as a result of that, Wall Street is making about $30 billion a year exclusively off of ADHD medications.
How do we prevent?
Education. I think education. Parents need to know what ADHD is. They need to know what the side effects are. No one's telling them about these drugs, the Metadates, the Adderalls, the Concertas, the Ritalins, the Cyclerts. No one's giving them the side effects. No one's telling them about how this can affect organ function, how it can affect growth and development, how it can cause permanent physical illnesses, diabetes, tic disorders, psychosis, extreme weight loss, extreme weight gain. And ironically, these medications cause more of the same symptoms that they're designed to eradicate.
Okay. Right now you're speaking primarily about African American boys.
Yes.
You see the proliferation of drugs in school kids, it seems, across races.
Yes.
Yes. So the profit that is being made is not necessarily just targeted at African American kids.
Very true. The profit is not just targeted at African American children. And in fact, the ADHD abuse goes beyond African American children. However, there is a overrepresentation. Disproportionality is the issue. African American boys are more likely to be diagnosed with ADHD than European American boys. They're more likely to be given a higher prescription. Okay, whereas a white kid might get 3 milligrams of Ritalin, the black kid might get 10. He's more likely to be prescribed more than one drug, and he's more likely to be given a stronger type of medication, and he's more likely to receive a less than beneficial medical management program that seeks to wean him off those drugs and make sure he's not being overdiagnosed with the medication. So yes, white boys suffer the same type of issue, but not to the same extent. It's the same thing with special ed, same thing with juvenile incarceration. There's white boys in juvenile incarceration as well, but the disproportionality is clearly on the side of the African American children.
Let me do a little bit of housekeeping here. When we promoted your appearance today on mm-hmm. various forms of social media, it was overwhelmingly supportive. Mm-hmm. People, one sister wrote awesomeness. Someone, a 76-year-old school teacher in Detroit, wrote just a glowing commentary mm-hmm. directly to me about having you on and the impact that you are having. You have your critics, and some of them even say that you are fraudulent,
yes.
That Dr. Umar Johnson is not a doctor. If you would share with us sort of
sure.
your educational background sure. and where and how you became a doctor.
Certainly. I graduated from Millersville University, Lancaster County, Pennsylvania, in 1997 with a Bachelor of Arts degree in psychology, a Bachelor of Science degree in political science. I returned to Millersville University in January of 98, and on August the 19th of the year 2000, I earned my master's degree in school psychology. I earned my school psychology certification from the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania in May of 2001. I then enrolled in Lehigh University in Bethlehem, PA, where I earned my master's degree in educational leadership and a subsequent Commonwealth of Pennsylvania certification as a school principal, which I've also been, and I earned my doctorate degree from the Philadelphia College of Osteopathic Medicine, an American Psychological Association approved program, and I graduated in July of 2012.
So one might surmise you kind of sort of know what you're talking about.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
And on top of that, I would also say that I've been an expert witness in due process cases on special education. I was also a part of the standardization team for many of the most popular IQ and achievement tests that are on the market now.
You have talked, you've used the word, you know, from a conspiratorial point of view, mm-hmm. and that is to point fingers at Wall Street, as you talked about mm-hmm. them making, you know, enormous profits from misdiagnosis
yes.
of these kids. And many would point to the responsibility and the lack of responsibility that is being taken in households mm-hmm. for these young boys. And you say?
I would agree to an extent. I do believe that parents are complicit in the problems in public school. I think that many of our parents don't do a good enough job of preparing their children for the seriousness of learning. I think in many of our households, we don't have parents who actually know the science behind behavior modification, so they don't know how to go about actually helping their children improve behavior without medication. I think a lot of our children come to school lacking the appropriate attention and nurturance that every child deserves from a parent, and they come to school looking for that from teachers, which can look like ADHD if you don't recognize normal children just looking for attention from adults. However, with that being said, and this is coming from both a former principal and a school psychologist, at the end of the day, it is my responsibility as the principal to make sure the children in my school learn. And it doesn't matter if the father's in jail, it doesn't matter if the mom's on welfare, it doesn't matter how poorly they were educated at previous schools. At the end of the day, they are my children, and I'm not gonna make excuses for why they don't learn. There's more than enough research out there that shows even children who come from these challenging backgrounds can learn when the people in front of them are actually committed to them improving. In fact, what is the number one finding that we see in mainstream research that relates to academic progress? The number one factor that determines whether or not a child learns in a class is not socioeconomic background, it is not a two-parent household, it is not the amount of money that the teachers are paid or the funding in the district. The number one factor is the teacher's belief in that child to learn. That supersedes every other factor that gets blamed for the failure of our children.
What's the formula? What's the formula for a low or practically no achieving child who, from whatever circumstances, mm-hmm. he comes into the classroom? What's the formula to get him to go from not knowing how to spell his name or whatever mm-hmm. his malady difficulty might be to becoming a proficient on-time student?
I would go to the three R's: rigor, relevance, and relationships. In our society, we put relevance first. No child left behind, reach to achieve. Everything is about getting the children ready for the test and making sure they score high. But the rigor cannot come first. The relationship has to come first, because a good teacher is like a good therapist. You have to be able to relate to those children. You have to earn their trust. And once they trust you, they'll be able to try and try harder as long as they know you'll be there to catch them if they fail. The problem is a lot of our teachers don't have healthy relationships with the children that they are teaching. The relationship is first. Number two, the lesson plans have to be relevant. Too often the instruction, and I've seen this myself as a principal, too often the instruction is not relevant to the children's everyday life. Mm-hmm. Teachers are not mm-hmm. spending enough mm-hmm. time developing those lesson plans so they are meaningful to the children. Mm-hmm. So you have to deal with that relationship, make sure the lesson plans are relevant, and then the rigor will come on its own.
Okay, now you talk about relationships and relevance. So now let's jump ahead for a moment and talk about the SAT test.
Yes.
And how for decades we've heard how SAT tests are not really fair to minority communities.
Yes.
In part because the questioning process and criteria for passing those are so different than the experience. How do we bridge that gap?
Well, number one, we have to understand that the SAT test, which was designed by Carl Brigham, a member of the American Eugenics Society and a racist. He's the father of the SAT test. See, when you deal with testing in general, you got to keep in mind why testing is so big in America. The purpose of testing in America is to give a scientific approach to make it look like people are responsible for why they're not given opportunities. Tests are
designed.
You're talking
specifically in education right now?
In education, and even outside of education. Testing is designed to exclude people from opportunity. The SAT test, the LSAT, the MCAT, the IQ test that I give, all tests in American society, because we live in a very hierarchical society and we live in a very racist society. And as a result of that, you have to come up with strategies that can deny people opportunity without it looking like blatant Jim Crow. The SAT test is beautiful for doing that. It systematically discriminates against African Americans.
How so?
Because of the language used in the test. The language is one of the biggest weapons of all standardized testing, because they deliberately use language that is confusing to African American children, because the words in the test are not part of the everyday repertoire of those children's vocabulary.
Can you give me an example of that?
I can't give you words from the test. But let's say I can't use words from the test. Not encyclopedia, that's common. Elated.
Okay.
Elated is a synonym for happy. So when asking a question, instead of saying, "What about this particular situation would make the protagonist happy about what happened?" They'll say, "What made the protagonist elated about what happened?" And now the child is totally thrown off, because they've never heard the word elated. The parent has never used it. The teacher has never used it. And for the first time, the word shows up as in the test. They get the answer wrong. Had a more appropriate synonym been used, they would have scored correctly. But because a synonym was used that the test designer knew would not be familiar to the test taker, the African-American child, they got the item wrong. The language is so confusing. Even when I look at it, and I've had teachers complain to me, "Dr. Johnson, look at the language in these tests. I don't even understand it as the classroom teacher." And so it is the language that is used to trick our children up to make sure they score below basic on these tests.
On that particular fundamental, just talking about the SAT test, okay, so my listening or viewing audience right now, you know, is like, okay, hey, I understand that. What can the community do? What can we do to help bridge the gap?
Number one, we should collect every cell phone, video game, and other electronic device that robs our children of time that they should be spending reading.
If I had a little bell right here that you hit on a counter when you go into a store and people in the back, I'd hit that bell and say that again, please.
Yes. Take back the cell phones, take back the Xboxes, the video games. All of these electronic gadgets that have our children's attention are robbing them of time that used to be spent when you were growing up and I was growing up reading. Our children don't read anymore. The average working vocabulary level of an African American and Latino child is 3 grades below their current class standing. So if they're in 8th grade, their vocab is 5th. And if they're in 5th grade, their vocab is 2nd. So if a 5th grader is taking a standardized test with these words that are quote unquote grade appropriate according to middle class norm, but their working vocab is on the 2nd grade level, imagine how many questions they're going to get wrong that they would have gotten right had they only understood the language.
And so we are talking about what is really habitually.
Yes.
A starting from way behind.
Yes.
Trying to catch up.
Yes. And that becomes an issue. Why? Because if you have a child in your classroom who is academically delayed, he's in the 6th grade reading on a 3rd grade level, but you see he's not learning disabled. He can learn. He's just so far behind that I would have to stop what I'm doing with the rest of my class to try to reach back and pull him up. It's easier for me to refer him to Dr. Johnson, the school psychologist, to get tested and placed in special ed. See, here's the problem for our teachers, and this is in defense of the teachers. A lot of them, black and white, want to help the children. The problem is the principal in the school district is saying, we don't have time for that. We have to get ready for the tests. And so they're like, well, I don't have time to go back and pull him up because I got to get ready for this test. And if I don't score high, they might transfer me to another school building. So he ends up being collateral damage because the teacher doesn't have any time in her schedule to really work with him during the regular day. And the principal is influencing the teacher to make the recommendation for special ed because there is no money to tutor the children. But there's a lot of money to special ed the children. So the onus is on special ed, not for academic rehabilitation.
You're making a whole lot of sense to me. When you talk to those with the purse strings in your state of Pennsylvania, what kind of reaction do you get when you bring forth this kind of justification for changing a system that is obviously failing?
I would say, and not only in Pennsylvania, because I travel and work with so many different school districts around the country, everyone says, you're right, but it's not politically expedient to bring these types of things up. For example, who controls education? The politicians. Yes. The state departments of education control education. Now, what is the number one agenda item on the table for most people running for office? Test scores, rigor. We want to make sure our kids are learning. Teachers have to be held to the highest standard. But when you have children who have been academically deprived, you have to first bring them up before you can hold them to that level of accountability. You see, pushing tests is not the way to improve education. All you do is heighten anxiety on behalf of the teachers. You take the fun out of learning for the children because everything is about a contest to see who passes and who fails. That type of school culture is not conducive to improving achievement. Am I against tests? No, I'm not, because tests do help us see where children are. I'm not even against the IQ test, because when I give an IQ test, it lets me see how a child thinks. Does it tell me how intelligent a child of color is? Mm-hmm. Of course not. It's racially biased. Mm-hmm. But it does help me in my assessment. My problem with standardized testing is that it is the be-all and end-all in determining what schools are successful and what schools are failing. I'm saying scale it back. It can still be a factor, but it should be a factor among many, not the only one that determines who's doing a good job.
If you waved a magic wand and the politicians did what you wanted done to improve the plight and the educational progress of especially students of color, because again, they're disproportionately affected. What is your message? What would your message to them
be? Three quick things.
Yeah.
Number one, there would be a national African-American and Latino male teacher recruiting initiative. You have to give black and Latino boys black and Latino male teachers. Most of these boys don't have a father figure at home, okay? And as a result of that, they're starving for masculine energy. So they have a home where mom is, and then they come to school and they have their learning mom, the teacher. Where is the masculine energy? These boys are crying out for a natural need to receive that nurturance from a male figure. Now, it might not be politically correct to talk about that, but it is true. Boys need men. And if you want to keep the attention of our boys, give them men. So the question becomes, why don't we see more black and Latino male teachers? It's because of the racism in America's public, private, parochial, and charter schools. 93% of all school teachers in America are white female. 97% of all teachers are female. Public education, since the beginning of American history, has been a female-dominated profession. And when you talk about bringing men in, even if it is for the underachieving boys of color, you're talking about a serious political dynamite issue, because women run schools, and they're not willing to relinquish that control for black and Latino boys to do better. That's why you've never heard President Obama. You've never heard none of your governors. You've never heard any mayors of the major cities talk about a serious black and Latino male recruitment teacher initiative, because they know it will not
fall favorably upon the ears of members of the teacher union. The Teachers Unions of America, the American Federation of Teachers, and the National Education Association, they don't want to hear anything about hiring no Black and Latino males, because in order to do that, you got to take jobs away from their females, and they're not going to have it. That's number one. Number two, I would order an audit of all children in special education in America. There will be an independent review board of school psychologists and educators that will review every child's folder in special ed to see whether they belong there in the first place. Because most children in special ed, Black or white, do not need it. They are there because the teacher didn't try hard enough, or the previous teacher didn't do a good enough job, or the parents weren't putting in their effort at home. Now, when I'm talking about this, I'm talking about the four biggest disabilities: the learning disability, mild mental retardation, emotional disturbance, and ADHD for other health impairment. I'm not talking about autism, speech and language, deafness. Those are real disabilities. Those children need special ed. But that learning disability, that ADHD, that emotional disturbance, and that mild mental retardation, most of the time, those are fraudulent diagnoses. They are fraudulent. And from a scientific standpoint, they cannot be proven to exist. You cannot absolutely prove ADHD. You cannot absolutely prove a learning disability. You cannot absolutely prove mild mental retardation. You cannot absolutely prove those diagnoses. So when they are given, it is the professional opinion of the evaluating psychologist only. Remember, when you deal with psychology, you're not dealing with medicine in the objective sense. If you have cancer, you can see that under a microscope. If you're a diabetic, there's evidence of the sugar levels in your blood. But when someone says your child has ADHD, there's no CAT scan, there's no X-ray. Yeah. There's no MRI. Mm-hmm. It is a professional opinion only. But I would order a review of all children in special education. And the third thing that I would do is I would bring back the building industrial trades in every predominantly Black and Latino neighborhood high school. Barbering, auto body, plumbing, electric, carpentry, HVAC, computer networking. Beginning in the 1970s, they stripped these programs out of the Black and Latino community, which meant everybody had to go to college, which is not a solution for us, because we have over 2 million college-educated African-American and Latinos in our community who cannot find work. So if the solution for our children is going to college, that's no solution at all, because the only thing you're guaranteed in college is debt to the banks for the rest of your life. Everyone doesn't want to go to college, nor does everyone need to go to college. What happened to using your hands to earn a living? My grandfather, he was a butcher. Him and my grandmother, they lived comfortably, quite well in Philadelphia. He didn't need a college degree. I have friends who are electricians and plumbers and carpenters. They do better than me economically, quite comfortable lives. They didn't have to go to college. Why are we sending all of our boys and girls to college? It's because they stripped our communities of the industrial trades, and they gave control of building trade to the white labor unions that dominate construction to this day. If you look at the new construction sites going up in Washington, D.C., it's either European American labor, Mexican labor, illegal immigrant labor, hardly any African-American or Latinos on those forces. Why? Because they don't have the training. They don't have the certifications. They were denied that in high school. 50 years ago, 40 years ago, you can graduate from high school certified as a plumber, electrician, carpenter, and go into work. What happened to that? That's why we have so many African-American and Latino boys going to jail. Because the economic opportunity has been stripped from their neighborhood and no one's talking about it. And I was told by a high-ranking member of the School Reform Commission of the School District of Philadelphia, I don't want to call the person's name, a couple years ago, I was told by this person, the reason why we cannot put the programs back into the high schools, the building trades, is because the unions of Philadelphia do not want it. And as I travel the country, I find it to be true everywhere. The white labor unions have a monopoly on the buildings contracts, and they don't want the high schools preparing Black children. This way, everyone has to go to the union for training and to get a job, and it equals more and more mass incarceration.
That was a lengthy but powerful answer. That was an impressive answer. Thank you for that.
Thank you.
I mentioned earlier in the program that you've inspired people and you've upset folks. And some of the words that you've used and the philosophy that you have put forth that have so upset folks was talking about the how the proliferation of black effeminate boys.
Yes.
And the root causes of that.
Yes.
Could you please tackle that for
me? And I'm glad you brought that up, because my position on black male effeminization has often been distorted as well as exaggerated by a lot of media outlets. Number one, let's deal with the facts. Fact number one, up until 1974, homosexuality was a mental illness in American society. If you get a copy of the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, that's the Bible of all diagnoses, it's in there.
Yeah.
Same-sex attraction is a mental illness. I have a copy of it. It was changed in 1974 at an annual conference of the American Psychiatric Association. And in the position paper, which I have, it clearly says that the removal of homosexuality from the diagnostic manual was not done because we have sufficient evidence to prove that this is a biologically innate personality trait. It says it. We didn't do this because we had proof that people are born this way. It was done for political reasons. In my own personal opinion, what I've studied, homosexuality was deregulated so that the LGBT movement could trump the black civil rights movement as the primary non-white issue in America. And it's already happening. You look at President Obama's behavior, he's made history. He signed more laws for the LGBT community. He hasn't signed a single law for black people since he's been in office. The only issue that matters in America now, the only minority issue, is the LGBT agenda. You hear almost nothing about black folk. That was the reason it was deregulated. However, although I don't support homosexuality, I cannot hate or deride the homosexual or the lesbian, because being a therapist, I do work with homosexual and lesbians, adults as well as youth. And in my experience, my direct clinical experience, most of the African American and Latino males that I have worked with, young and old, were all victims. 9 out of every 10, there were a few exceptions, were victims of pedophilia in their early years, normally before 12.
And you suggest then that that pedophilia contributed to their lifestyle behavior.
Well, not even what I suggest. What they say in therapy is, I am this way because my first sexual act was with a male. And for whatever reason, Dr. Johnson, it's done something to me that makes me feel that this is the way I'm supposed to be, coming from the client. And of course, there's always different perspectives on the etiology of homosexuality. But why do you never hear that voice? Why do you never hear discussion on the role of early sexual molestation as a trigger for homosexuality? Am I saying every single person who's gay was a victim of childhood molestation? No, I'm not. But why has there been no discussion on the many who have? In my experience, and I've met probably close to 100 gay or lesbian African-American and Latino brothers and sisters, and guess what? Most of them had that as the etiology. I work with lesbian girls in the high schools. They'll tell me in a minute, you know why I'm this way? I wasn't born this way, Dr. Johnson. I'm this way because I was sexually molested. I grew up in a house where I saw my mother get beat on by my father. So I have a distrust and almost a hatred towards black men. I'm consciously living with another woman because I'm afraid to live with a black man. I've had these things told to me. And why is this not on the public discussion? It's because they want to push, in my opinion, homosexuality, not for marital reasons or sexual freedom reasons, but as a population control strategy, because two black men can't make a child, two black women can't make a child. In fact, if you look at many of the funders of the LGBT movement, they're not LGBT. They are heterosexuals who are proliferating the behavior because they know for every gay black man, that's a man who will not be bringing children into this world. Those are women who will not be bringing children into this world. But do I hate my brothers and sisters because they have this situation? No, I don't.
Is it a mischaracterization of your position that that no one is born homosexual?
No, that is my position. African people, I can't speak for other cultures, but for African people, I haven't come across any evidence whatsoever in my own direct experience with LGBT members, as well as in literature that I would consider credible. And I say credible because much of the literature that pushes LGBT as a normal way of life is funded by LGBT interest groups. So how can you trust the research when the research is being funded by people who belong to that particular population? It's just like with drug research. The drug companies fund the research to determine if their drug is safe. How can you trust that research? But in research that I've seen that's credible and neutral, there's no evidence to suggest African-American folk are born that way. And I've had respectable conversations with members of the LGBT community. Okay, I've been on radio shows. I've been challenged by gay, lesbian men and women who said, listen, we want to challenge you on this issue. Are you willing to come on a radio show? Sure, because it's not a disrespect thing. Mm-hmm. It's not a disrespect thing. There's still people. And do you know that African-American gay men have one of the highest suicide rates in the country? Do you really think I'm going to disrespect, impugn, and deride my brother who's a homosexual when I know that he's more likely to take his life than almost any other black man in the community? So the propaganda is that because Dr. Johnson doesn't support homosexuality and lesbianism, it automatically follows that he hates the homosexual and the lesbian. That's not my position. I love all African people, regardless of whatever their persuasion is, but I reserve the right not to advocate behaviors that I feel are not in the best interest of my people, but I do not hate you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I mentioned the 76-year-old teacher from from Detroit. I said, what would you like to ask Dr. Johnson? And one question was, please draw a parallel, if there is one, between low self-esteem in the African-American boys and pending mental illness.
Wow. I don't think we have to limit that to African-American boys.
Yeah.
I'm saying that because in most clients I've had, and I've had black, white, Latino, every color, every race, every socioeconomic class, self-esteem is always, most of the time, a contributing issue to whatever the mental illness is. If it's bipolar, if it's depression, if it's anxiety. Think about it, if you have depression, you're depressed about your ability to change your reality, which is contingent on the fact that your self-concept is so low that you have an external local self-control, you don't feel you can impact your destiny. Low self-esteem, anxiety, consistent worry. Why do people suffer from general anxiety disorder? You're worried that you don't have the self-control or competence to affect your life. ADHD, for example, kids who are diagnosed with that, the research shows they suffer from lower self-esteem because, number one, they're stigmatized, and then they're marginalized, okay, and then they're pathologized, and then on top of all that, it affects the way they see themselves. In fact, I argue that one of the biggest problems with diagnosing our kids with these glow-in-the-dark disabilities, one of the biggest problems is the resultant low self-esteem. Imagine somebody telling you you're retarded. I'm 40 years old. If someone told me at 40 I was retarded, that would hit me a little bit. If someone told me I was learning disabled, that would hit me a little bit. If someone told me I was emotionally disturbed at 40 years old, that would hit me. Imagine being told that at 4. Imagine being told that at 10. Imagine being told that at 14. I was an expert witness. In fact, I was an expert evaluator in a case in Philadelphia. Public Interest Law Center took a school district to court. School District of Philadelphia, the African-American boy misdiagnosed as retarded in the eighth grade. When I evaluated him, he was an adult, 22. My job was to come in, reevaluate, and see whether or not he was really ever mentally retarded, which is now called intellectual disability. President Obama changed it in 2009. The young man was not mentally retarded at all. But the problem is what? When I sat down to go over my test results with him, it didn't matter because for the past 6-8 years, he has already been socialized, conditioned, indoctrinated to believe he's retarded. So the fact that he now knows the truth means nothing because it's now in his subconscious, which is why I try to encourage parents, teachers, stop telling children these labels. It does not benefit the child. I've never seen a child be benefited by being told you're learning disabled or be helped, you're ADHD. You have mild mental retardation. What benefit is it for that child to know that the adults in their life have given them a glass ceiling?
What should they be told?
They should be told that there is no ceiling for how well they can do. Remember now, when we're talking about mental health and psychology, it's not an exact science.
Yeah.
There's always room for growth. You know how many children I've tested who are quote unquote crack babies? And they come into kindergarten, and I got a note from the doctor saying this kid is probably going to be in special ed the whole life skill, and they end up being mentally gifted. the kids who were autistic-y early on in life, and the doctors and the experts said, you know, this kid is going to need all types of aids, and now they're lawyers and doctors. You see, so for me, I don't believe in putting ceilings on people's potential. We don't know that. The only entity that knows what that child can become is God. And as far as I'm concerned, until that child proves to themselves that they're not capable of doing it, we shouldn't stop them. Now, if it's obvious with blindness, if it's obvious with deafness, that's another situation. But when you're talking about these subjective diagnoses, we should be very careful in giving them to children, even with mentally gifted children. I tell parents, never tell your child their IQ score. Why shouldn't I tell my child his IQ score? He got a 140. Because when he gets to Harvard and Yale and Princeton, they have 160s. So now in D.C., he's looking bright. But when he gets to Harvard, he feels he's less than competent because all of his classmates have an IQ of 160. Telling children their diagnosis never helps.
When you approach the individual child, can you give an example of someone that has come to you with all of these socially negative labels, learning disabled or whatever?
Okay.
You got any success stories you could tell us about?
Dozens.
Examples.
Yeah. I would say, okay, well, we just talked about one, the kid who was diagnosed as mentally retarded, but I don't know if I can call it a success story because it has not changed.
It's a work in progress.
But I've had, I would say every year, every school year from September to June, I find about a dozen African-American Latino children, sometimes white children, because I evaluate. White parents call me up as well, believe it or not. Most people would never even know that. White parents call Dr. Umar? Yes, they do, because number one, I'm not a racist. Number two, I love children. I don't care what color they are.
Some people try to give you the reputation as an angry black man.
Exactly, exactly. And a lot of the white parents whose children I advocate for, they wouldn't feel comfortable letting the public know that that black man who you think is a racist saved my son. They're not gonna do that, you know, because then they'll be stigmatized. But I think it's important that the public knows that I work with children of all backgrounds, and because of my reputation as a fighter, white parents have no problem calling me up. Okay, Lower Marion School District, Upper Marion School District. I mean, these are some of the richest school districts in
America. Outside of Philadelphia.
Yeah, who will call me up and say, hey, I need you. Even parents in other states will call me up for consultation. I can't practice in the state, but I can consult with them on the issue involving their child. So I get requests from parents of every shade and every socioeconomic status. And why? Because when they listen to me, they see that that man never once said he hate us. He never once said, I want to do something to all white folk. He said he is unapologetically for his own people first, as we all are. So why is he different from the rest of us? Because it's not popular in America to be proud to be black. And those of us who are proud to be black are castigated and ridiculed, but I refuse to abandon my position. Our children need to see examples of unapologetic black men. They have to see it. Even though we're going to be castigated and marginalized, it's very important that they see that it's absolutely nothing wrong with loving who you are. And that's one of the reasons why I want to build the Frederick Douglass and Marcus Garvey Academy, because I believe for our children to receive a proper education, we have to give it to them. So I want to build a residential academy where the boys live there. Why do I want them to live there? Because there's too many messages coming to our children that are negative. The TV, the radio, parents with their poor supervision.
I want to get to the to your aspiration for developing a school like that. But I wanted to come back sort of in the low part of the weeds and to go through one of those examples
of what you do
that has brought some positive results in a kid's life.
Here's one of the good things. Special education requires that a child with a diagnosis be reevaluated every couple years to see whether or not they still qualify. So let's say a child comes to me as diagnosed as mentally retarded. Okay, I evaluate this child, I give him an IQ test. Boom, the IQ score now, 6 years later from the original diagnosis, said this kid is high average or gifted or at least within the average range. Then I give him the achievement test, okay? He's still delayed, but intellectually, he's not retarded. And I have it here in black and white. So I can now tell him, his parents, the teacher, the principal, this child was misdiagnosed as mentally retarded. And by the way, in America, a black boy is four times as likely as a white boy to be diagnosed as retarded. Let's take learning disabled. You got a kid who was diagnosed as with a reading disability in the third grade. You're doing a reevaluation in the sixth grade. You give him the reading assessment, boom, he got a 110 standard score. You give him another, he got a 90 standard score. Wow, can he do better? Of course, but guess what? He no longer falls within a deficient range. So then the question becomes, if you're saying he's not reading disabled in the sixth grade, how did they say he was reading disabled in the third grade? You know why? Because they rush to judgment. Whenever you evaluate a child below fourth grade, you have to be careful. There's a lot of factors involved in why they might be low. Mm-hmm. Primary what? Poor instruction. Mm-hmm. A lot of kids haven't been taught. What about the kids who've been transferred to three or four different schools? Parents, under no fault of their own, because of living circumstances, children regularly go to four or five different schools. Well, if he's been to five different schools, five different teachers, five different curriculums, of course he's going to be behind.
What? Nutrition.
Nutrition is critical mm-hmm. because, number one, a lot of our children eat too much sugar, too much caffeine, too much high fructose corn syrup. And when you're under the influence of sugar, as you know, you will look very much like ADHD. Mm-hmm. So before we even look for ADHD, there should be a sugar detox. Sugar detox. I recommend it to parents. Before you go running off looking for some Ritalin, which is going to cause nothing but more problems, detox your child off of sugar, caffeine, and high fructose corn syrup. Go home, throw everything in the trash that has sucrose, lucrose, any type of crose on it. Throw it out. Give them 6 weeks. Let's see what the behavior.
I hear you have a sense of being critical of Ritalin.
Why? Ritalin, according to the Drug Enforcement Agency, is nothing more than a variation of the street drug Speed. It is one molecule away from crack cocaine. I'm very critical of Ritalin because that same Ritalin on the street corner is called crack and sends black men to jail with mandatory 5, 10, 15, 20 year minimums for selling it, but you'll take the same crack off the corner that sent his father to jail, call it Ritalin, Concerta, meditate, and give it to his son so he can sit still long enough to be miseducated. To me, that is hypocrisy. How can America claim to have a war against drugs, putting millions of black men in jail while you addict millions of black boys on the same drug that you're locking up black men for selling? That is an unacceptable hypocrisy.
What is the reaction of the school districts mm-hmm. in which you serve?
It depends on their agenda. If they are an advocate of black boys, they love me. There's certain school districts around this country, they bring me in every year to train their teachers, train their principals, train their psychologists. Like clockwork, it's just on the calendar. Every year you're coming. I was just at a school up in New York not too long ago. I do work for schools all around the country, you know? So if you are an advocate of black boys, you want me, because I'm gonna come in, I'm gonna show you how to work with them. I'm gonna show you how you don't need special ed. I'm gonna show you how they don't need Ritalin. Let's do a school-wide behavior program that matters. And then I'll sit down with the white teachers and answer any misconceptions they have about me, because they gotta trust me before they work with me. So I'll sit down with them, okay, what have you heard? What do you need to know? So we can get through that and let's focus on what we heard. And then we get with that. Get through that, then we can move forward. Now, if your agenda is to get paid off misdiagnosing kids, if you are a special education hustler, if you are a Ritalin advocate, I am your worst nightmare. You do not want to see me. I got school districts who don't want me nowhere in the city, because if I set foot in that school, I'm going to find about 50 cases of kids on drugs and in special ed who do not belong there. See, the biggest advantage black parents have in working with me is I know educational law very well. Mm-hmm. School psychology is based on the law. You have to know it. Mm-hmm. Schools don't like that. Yeah. They rely on black and Latino parents not to know their rights. They don't want you to know that because your son is in special education, he can't be suspended more than 10 total days the entire school year. They don't want you to know that. They don't want you to know that if you don't want your child in special ed, you can call an IEP meeting and take him out. They don't want you to know that the principal can't expel your child. He has no power to do that. He can only refer downtown to the local school board. They don't want black and Latino parents to know their rights. I teach them their rights. Mm-hmm. I empower them so they can fight for their children without me being next to them.
You undertook an effort mm-hmm. to attempt to purchase in Virginia mm-hmm. St. Paul College that went under.
Yes.
Is that still ongoing?
Let me tell you what happened with that. It's still a possibility, but it's no longer the priority. Why? Because as of about a week or two ago, St. Paul's is now, or should I say Motley's, the real estate company that's representing the sale, okay, they're now selling sections of the college. That is bad news for me, because I need the whole college. Once I get to the $2 million mark, I need the whole college. But now they're selling off the student center. Yeah. They've already sold off the 300 extra acres. They're selling off the house at the front of the campus. My question to St. Paul's would be, because we're at $250,000 now. We're 1/8 of the way. We got 7/8 to go. When I do get the $2 million, how much of St. Paul's is still going to be there for me to buy it? So it's no longer a priority.
So you wanted it, and what did you want to do with it?
I was going to turn that into the Frederick Douglass and Marcus Garvey Academy. It would have been perfect. Perfect. In the middle of nowhere, 137 acres, surrounded by an African-American community, small enough to control, but large enough to do everything we needed to do. Brand new student center, gym, dorms. We had everything. I just needed the money, and I came up short, so they back out selling it again. But I'm going to be visiting another school in Port Gibson, Mississippi, Chamberlain Hunt Academy. I visited it this past Kwanzaa when I was down there speaking for Kwanzaa. It's a military residential school. It just closed a few months ago. Still going to cost us about $2 million. They actually want a little more, but I think I can get them down to $2 million. Once again, a perfect school for our children. And it's in Mississippi, the most predominant black state in the union. You know, so I'm going down there to meet with the NAACP. They invited me, Port Gibson NAACP, Tuesday, February the 10th, to present my vision for Chamberlain Hunt in hopes of getting the African-American community of Mississippi behind me to raise this money so we can give our boys the school that they
need. And
deserve.
You would take that school, you have to present to them to tell them what your mission is. And what is your mission?
Well, my mission is to provide our children with an education that prepares them to go into business for themselves without no college education. It will be college prep because some of our children want to be doctors and lawyers, sure. And they should be able to, and we want to make sure they're prepared. But we want to make sure all of our children are able to earn a decent living even if they don't go to college. I want to bring the industrial trades there. I want to make sure our children are experts in real estate by the time they graduate. I want to make sure they are experts in the stock market, trades, and investments before they graduate, because you can become a millionaire purely off learning how to invest effectively. Black kids have been told for too long the only way to get wealthy is through college. Yeah. The top 1% richest people in this country and in this world never went to college. We have to stop lying. You don't need to waste 6 years of your life before you get started on your economic destiny. Start right after high school. So the focus of the school will be self-reliance and independence. You don't need college and you don't need a handout. You need to develop your mind.
What will be your strategy to attract the male teacher that you say is so sorely missing now?
Actually, at the risk of sounding arrogant, I won't have to. And I'm only saying that because we've already gotten about 600 resumes already. And anyone who wants to send a resume can send it to fdmgresumes@gmail.com.
You know what? I absolutely, without any apologies to anyone, want to go very slow.
No problem.
When you give that information, give it out, because I want my viewing audience to at least be aware.
Okay, okay.
So give that out.
It's FDMG, which is the acronym for Fred Douglass Marcus Garvey, the initials. FDMG resumes, R-E-S-U-M-E-S, @gmail.com. FDMG resumes @gmail.com. I'm asking folks to send their resume with a cover letter, simply telling me what do they think they bring to the table for our children. And not just instructional staff either. We're gonna need bus drivers, security guards, nurses, secretaries, house parents who live with the children. We're gonna need farmers, barbers. We need it all, because this is gonna be a mini nation. So we have about 600 resumes now. I want as many as we can get, because the vision is to open up a FDMG everywhere where there's a sizable population of African-American children.
The name, Frederick Douglass Marcus Garvey Academy. Right. And why was that chosen?
Well, Frederick Douglass, I'm a blood relative. He's a great-great-great-great-granduncle of mine and a hero of mine, okay? So, in fact, he's the standard I compare myself next to, okay? So, in honor of him and Marcus Garvey, I'm a Garveyite, a Pan-Africanist, leader of the largest black organization in modern history, the most successful organizer of black folk, and the only black leader who never took a dollar from another people. Only one. So Frederick Douglass and Marcus Garvey, to me, although ideologically they're opposite, Frederick the integrationist, Garvey the nationalist, but they were each the greatest leader, and black leader, in the respective century in which they lived. And I believe that in studying the dichotomy between the two of them, every political ideology that black people espouse is represented between the Frederick Douglass on this end and a Marcus Garvey on this end dichotomy, because I want to give our children a thorough political education. I don't want to exclude them from any particular line of thought. I want them to learn Dr. King. I want them to learn Malcolm. You understand? I want them to learn the history of Christianity, Islam. I'm not shielding my children from nothing, because at the end of the day, truth is consistent, and you don't have to hide a child from anything if you really believe that what you're teaching is the truth.
You use the word Pan-Africanism.
Yes.
We have about a minute and a half. Mm-hmm. Tell us what Pan-Africanism is.
Pan-Africanism can be summed up in three basic principles. Number one, all African people, regardless of skin color, regardless of language, regardless of culture, or nationality, or religion, are one family. That's principle number one. We are family first. You and I are not the same shade, but we're both African. Family first. I might speak Spanish, you might speak English, you might be Muslim, I might be Christian, but we are family first. That's principle number one. Principle number two, we identify with that African family before we identify with any other allegiance. So I'm an African who happens to be a Christian. I'm not a Christian who happens to be an African. Our Africanity is first. And principle number three, as Africa goes, so goes the rest of us. We believe that Africa must be a part of our political and economic strategy because we cannot improve ourselves better than the condition of Africa. The children around the world will never excel the mothership in terms of how they are treated. Chinese people get respect no matter where they live because China gets respect. Anglo-Saxons get respect no matter where they live because Europe gets respect. If black people in America want respect, we don't have to go back to Africa, not all of us, but we better help Africa improve herself so she can protect us.
Very, very, very much respect.
Thank you.
From the Rock Newman Show. Dr. Umar Johnson, thank you again for being here. This has been fabulous. Folks, that wraps us for today. Woo! For more information on this program or any other program produced by WHUT, go to WHUT.org. I'm Rock Newman. God bless you, and I'll see you the next time.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.